plant flowers. What a long talk to just tell you to plant some flowers, right? But I mean it. And not just plant flowers, but plant diverse flowers. Plant different flowers. Think about not what one or two things do bees really like, but how can you extend the life of the blooms throughout the growing season? What blooms in March? What blooms in April? What blooms in May? Keep it going as long as you can. So up here in Cambridge, we're thinking March through October, typically. That's the best thing, a varied diet. If you eat pizza every day, it might be tasty at first, but then you're not going to feel so well, right? Same thing for bees. So if they're in a monoculture crop farmland with just one thing to eat, we do see hits to their health. So we're thinking that this last hypothesis that we're left with, perhaps habitat in cities, might be what's giving them some better health. Overwinter survival seems to be better. Honey yield, as we talked about, seems to be higher. And a recent study out of England showed that in at least four cities in England, bee diversity, so getting all the way back to the beginning here, those other thousands of species of bees, there are more of them in urban environments compared to their surrounding countrysides. Well, thank you very much, Mary, and to the Cambridge Forum, and to each of you for being here tonight. I really appreciate it. If the bees had feelings, I'm sure they would appreciate it too. Who knows? Maybe they do have feelings. You know, there is so much that we still do not even understand about bees, much less even knowing that they are right outside these very walls of this building. I mean, of course we know there are bees there, but what do we really know about them? Do we really even notice them? I like to think about this question in terms of my childhood. So if you can, we'll take a little field trip back to our respective childhood, and we'll think about the wonder, right? When you leave the house and your parents are like, go play, go scram, do something, go away. And you go outside and it was a whole wondrous world out there. It's still quite a wondrous world, but I don't think that we notice it anymore as adults. You know, life happens and we go to work and we come home and we eat dinner and go to bed. I mean, certainly we do more things like come to events like this with the Cambridge Forum, but we don't notice that there are about 4,000 species of bees right outside here, really, in the Americas. There are 20,000 different species of bees around the world. Honeybees, you might think about, like what beekeepers work with. We're thinking bees, we're thinking, oh yeah, I like honey, right? So that's one species, more or less, of the 20,000. So if you can compare this to a classroom, for example, with 20,000 students in it, it's a big classroom, right? Think about that for the diversity of bees. And then you have one teacher's pet, right? That one student out of 20,000 students sitting in the front center answering every question, me, 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 choose me, look at me. And the other 19,900 and something students or bee species not getting any credit for being quite smart, right? Those other bees do so much work. Think about the alfalfa leaf cutter bee, for example. So the what, right? So the alfalfa leaf cutter bee, it's a thing, right? So you can think, okay, alfalfa, that's kind of like a sprout, right? Leaf cutter, that's kind of weird, but I get it. I understand what that bee might do. But did you know that this alfalfa leaf cutter bee contributes $9 billion to the US economy every year? Okay, so how does one weird bee species contribute $9 billion, right? I mean, imagine what Congress could do if we found that lost money, you know, amongst all the other things happening in our budget. But that pollinates the crops that our cattle rely upon. So what do cattle eat? It's hay and alfalfa, right? You can be like my father is and think, oh, bees, yeah, okay, like my son is a bee scientist, and so, yeah, that's like maybe where my food comes from, but I don't like fruits and vegetables anyway, right? So this is like what pops do, right? So my father is saying, I don't eat fruits and vegetables, so I don't really care about bees, but I care about you, son, and I'm proud of you, which he is, and I'm grateful for that. But if he eats meat, he's a meat and potatoes kind of guy, okay, that's where the bees come in, right? So if you eat food, then you care about bees. Luckily, I think we're past that now, though. So me telling you this, I don't think anybody's having a big revelation right now, like, oh, bees, that's why we're here. Of course you get it, that is why you're here. But there's so much more to the story. So going back to my own story, I wasn't the type of kid who grew up playing in the dirt, looking at bugs. I grew up in Fairfield, Connecticut, right outside of New York City. That's where I was born. And my family was in the city. My father proposed to my mother on the big screen at a Mets game, Shea Stadium, right? Two single Manhattanites falling in love and having a little bee scientist kid, right? I would play on the rooftops with my cousin in New York because that's where his school was, and there were playgrounds. And of course, to a kid, you go with it. Why? What's the big deal, a playground and a slide 20 feet up in the air? I would look at the other rooftops. I remember this so clearly, and I would wonder, are there other kids on those rooftops? Are there slides? Are there better slides? What's happening there? And that particular piece of wonder never left me as I grew older. I'm still so fascinated with rooftops that even now with my work at the MIT Media Lab, where I'm a research affiliate, very sexy title there, we are studying things like what's on rooftops. And I've been able to meet companies, corporate decision makers who are in charge of things like corporate sustainability, to ask them the question, what's on your rooftop? I've met with IKEA thinking, you have a lot of rooftop, right? Around the world, what's on there? And these are things that people have never really seemed to ask, because the answer is always, I don't know, nothing? Beehives, maybe? Should we do that? Right? So we started doing that as a function of a fundraiser for our research. So I ended up studying bees when I started school. It was really a function of me being pre-med in college because my father told me to. And then when I was getting ready to apply to medical school, I realized, this isn't for me. I'm going to become a medical doctor for my father, who wanted to be a medical doctor, and so that's how this works, right? Well, wrong. I took a left turn. I had a really inspiring teacher named Becky Rosengaus, and she studied what she said in her Mexican accent as termites. And I said, I don't know what you're studying. I don't know what you just said, but I really enjoy your energy. She was new, vibrant, a new teacher to the department at Northeastern University. And she hired me to work in her termite lab as a research assistant. And I thought termites, it's kind of weird. It's not really my thing, but they're social animals. And we're social. We're social creatures here. We're all out here tonight talking to one another. And so that's what fascinated me about termites. How are termites able to stay healthy despite all of this disease out there that societies get, right? If somebody sneezes tonight, I can promise you a couple other people will think I'm going to get sick. We just know that because that's how social kind of medicine issues tend to go. When it was time for graduate school, Becky Rosengaus said, why don't you think about this bee program at Tufts? I know you like medicine and societies, but you can take all of that outside and study bee medicine. So I said, okay, that sounds nice. Let's give it a go. So I started in 2005 at Tufts, and I was studying honeybee immunology, which is essentially the focus of my dissertation, and that's what my PhD work is on. And 2006, so 1 year after I started, honeybees started dying, and not just dying, but disappearing. So no dead bodies. It was this kind of CSI bee situation. And everybody loves a good CSI story these days. This is why the bee die-offs made the cover of Time magazine, and May Barenbaum, a wonderful researcher, wrote an article in 2007 in the New York Times that explained this to the general public. It was essentially like, hey, I'm a scientist, yes, but I'm going to write this in plain terms. Bees are dying, and if you need food, you need to pay attention. And that's really the piece that communicated this to the general public and got everybody's attention, thinking, oh, where does our food come from? And the farm-to-table movement was really happening at the same time in restaurants. People started talking about, at least, where does this food come from? Where does food at all come from? And what is a bee, and why should we care? Because people started asking me, 1 year into graduate school, what was happening with bees, it made me find out. I had no idea what the answer was. And even though these days, as Dave Hackenberg and I can both tell you, we've got some really good data sets to get us some information about what's killing bees, but there's yet to be a global consensus about what is the killer of bees. We know these neonics, these neonicotinoid pesticides are a problem, and we know that varroa mites are a problem, and Nosema, which is a fungal infection of bees, that's a problem too. But there are more problems than we can understand, especially how they interact synergistically with one another, and then also what can we do? So what can each of you do to really help? I started a company while I was a graduate student, and it was really out of a necessity to raise funding for research. Research funds are still not there, and my lab was celebrating a decade of National Science Foundation grant rejections. We'd have a little party, and we would say, we're going for 11, right? Because it was almost a badge of honor, but it became a little too counterproductive. That takes time and resources to write a failing grant, even a successful one. I mean, it takes the same amount of energy, but the payoff is quite different, right? So I was getting ready to graduate around 2009 in a bad economy with a PhD in honeybee immunology. There are no jobs out there in a good economy for people with a PhD in honeybee immunology. So I did what any millennial does these days, is I started a Facebook page and I made up a name. I said, oh, it's called the Best Bees Company? I don't know, and I just have to keep moving. And this is free, and I've never taken a business class in my life, but let's give it a go. Nothing to lose. Somebody said, okay, I'll buy a beehive. I said, you will? So the Facebook page said, I'm selling beehives to raise funding for bee research and volunteering my time to manage them for anybody who wants a beehive. Who wants some bees? I thought everybody was doing this. I thought it was dumb. And as I said, somebody wanted one. And so eventually it was a second person and a third person. And then it turned into an opportunity to give a talk at TEDx Boston in 2012. Now, by then I had accumulated 3 years of data from living in Boston, looking at beehives in Boston, Cambridge, and Somerville, and comparing those hives to other communities as well. I was getting smacked in the face with these data sets that were honey harvest levels. So the amount of honey coming out of these three cities, Cambridge, Boston, and Somerville, Massachusetts, was way more than any other surrounding suburb or rural area. It wasn't even a question we set to ask, right? I was doing immunology. I was developing vaccines and looking at how molecules and cells and proteins interacted. But you couldn't deny that these huge honey harvests were coming in from the city. I mean, we had one little old lady's beehive on a second floor deck make 128 pounds of honey this 1 month in Somerville, right? This is like the city, right? So this was shocking. And so we started looking at our data sets from the past few years. And at that TEDx Boston talk in 2012, I presented the data. Short talk, I said, here's what I found, you know, what do you think? And it went viral, as they say, and you can find it on Netflix now, which is so weird, but it's bee data on Netflix, right? So it's kind of cool at the same time. The research has really been successful in the past 7 years. We have 6 current students now who are college interns. They're getting academic credit, they're getting paid by the hour, and they're publishing papers showing that we've got some significant effects still with urban beekeeping. We're exploring those. We don't understand why bees in cities tend to do so well. But what we do know is that bees are doing better the higher up you go. So over 50 feet in height is where we have the healthiest beehives. So as of last year, the Best Bees Company went national into 8 cities with skyscraper rooftops. It is so bizarre, I know, but I'll be the first one to tell you that it's going very well in most cities, not every place. And places like Los Angeles have just legalized beekeeping this past fall of 2015. It was illegal for over 130 years. And you wonder, why would beekeeping be illegal? Well, maybe because these are stinging insects in downtown Los Angeles, so that might make sense, right? That's not it at all. Beekeeping in LA was made illegal because people thought that bees attacked fruit. So we'll think about the fruit, right? Okay, so there's bees on your fruit trees, but they're pollinators, right? This is where our food comes from. Well, unlike tonight, where each of you can understand where our food comes from a little bit better than in the 1870s, they didn't understand it then, and so they said, let's make them illegal. So that's why bees were banned. And 130-something years later, we're very proud to have changed that law, and now beekeeping is legal in LA. And so we're trying to just educate people about what's a bee, what's a hornet, what's a wasp, what's a yellow jacket. They all look the same, yes, but they're very different. And bees are all vegan. That's a fun thing that makes a bee and not a wasp. Bees and wasps split about 100 million years ago in evolutionary history, really when the first prototypes, protoflowers, came to be, these little kind of ugly mutations in plants that became today's flowers. And a subset of wasps kind of ran off and had a love affair with these first flowers on Earth, and they diversified rapidly. So they left their cousins, the meat-eating wasps, behind, which is really why wasps are more aggressive. They have to hunt for food. They're meat eaters. Kind of like the T-Rex. And then you've got some big brontosauri, or we've got some bees who are the vegetarians. So they're different. Their nature's different. Even though honeybees have stingers, they die when they sting, so they tend to be much less aggressive than the wasps and the like. I want to close in just giving you a little bit more hope and prescription, as one might say, because our recent data have been really counterintuitive and fascinating about bee health. We've been looking at everything that could possibly affect bee health, and when we visit beehives, our whole team of, we've got 42 beekeepers nationwide now in cities, collecting data with this iPhone app, looking at what's affecting bees. We had three main hypotheses. So, based off of what's killing bees, we were looking at pesticides, diseases, and habitat loss. Those are the three leading hypotheses for what's affecting bee health. So again, pesticides, which really includes fungicides and herbicides and any chemical in that sense. And then diseases, of which bees get viruses, bacterial, fungal infections, and habitat loss, so less flowers, and that affects their nutrition, as Rachel Benoen here tonight can certainly comment on as well. We've ruled out two of the three in our recent unpublished data. So we have found diseases at comparable levels, not just in cities, but also in suburbs and rural environments. So even though bee health seems to vary across these habitats, there's no variation or very little in disease levels. So we ruled that out as maybe what's driving bee health in urban environments or any other one where bees are doing well. We've also ruled out pesticides in terms of this particular question, which again is why are bees doing better in urban environments here? Looking across our data where there's variation, what else is varying accordingly? What correlates with that? Pesticides are everywhere. These neonicotinoid pesticides are something that are very sticky and they're light, and it's like many other classes of pesticides that can just travel much farther than we really expected, unless you're testing other sites further away from the spray site. But they travel further. So they're at high levels at certain times in the city, just as they are in farmland. So we ruled that out based on our data. And that was working with Alex Liu's lab at the Harvard School of Public Health. So what are we left with? This is where you come in, right? Habitat, plant flowers. What a long talk to just tell you to plant some flowers, right? But I mean it. And not just plant flowers, but plant diverse flowers, plant different flowers. Think about not what one or two things do bees really like, but how can you extend the life of the blooms throughout the growing season? What blooms in March? What blooms in April? What blooms in May? Keep it going as long as you can. So up here in Cambridge, we're thinking March through October, typically. That's the best thing, a varied diet. If you eat pizza every day, it might be tasty at first, but then you're not going to feel so well, right? Same thing for bees. So if they're in a monoculture crop farmland with just one thing to eat, we do see hits to their health. So we're thinking that this last hypothesis that we're left with, perhaps habitat in cities, might be what's giving them some better health. Overwinter survival seems to be better. Honey yield, as we talked about, seems to be higher. And a recent study out of England showed that in at least four cities in England, bee diversity, so getting all the way back to the beginning here, those other thousands of species of bees, there are more of them in urban environments compared to their surrounding countrysides. So we're only beginning to discover, first off, well, that bees are important. Luckily, I do think we're past that. But now, okay, if we know that they're dying, then where are they not dying? Is, I think, the next simplest question to ask. And we're starting to be able to answer it. And it's great that the solution comes right back to you. So go plant some flowers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary, and thank you, everybody, tonight. And thanks for the invitation to be here and speak to you tonight about something that's very passionate to my heart. As Mary said, I've been keeping bees for a long time. I started keeping bees in 1962 as a VOAG project. I was born and raised in a dairy farm in central Pennsylvania. I didn't like milking cows, and more or less things happened. My father got hurt in a farm accident, and I started keeping bees as a VOAG project, and most of the rest is history. Today, my family, my son, my wife, and some helpers, we run normally several thousand hives of bees. Right now we're about 1,600, but we're pushing those numbers back up again. And we have done this for, like Mary said, we've done this for going on 50 years. A lot of things have changed since the time I started keeping bees. When I first started keeping bees, bees pretty much took care of themselves, kept themselves. The idea of trucking bees across the United States from the East Coast to California to pollinate almonds in the middle of the winter, that was never unheard of. That was unheard of. There were just a lot of things back in those days. I mean, bees pretty much took care of themselves. I joke about the fact that we kept bees, we fished and we hunted, and then we took care of the bees a little bit, and we fished and hunted some more. Today, we keep bees probably 365 days a year, because if we don't, because of the problems that are going on, it comes back to haunt us. What you got to understand is a colony of bees is made up of a lot of individuals. It's, you got brood, and you got the, you know, the queen and the worker bees, but that bees that are in that hive are a lot of different age individuals, and each one of them has a job. And if something gets out of sync, the population gets out of sync, the population dynamics, something happens to the population dynamics, you don't have the right ages of bees in that hive, something's going to happen down the road that's going to come back to haunt the viability of that hive. And so in 2006, when I'm credited, I guess, more or less with finding what's now called colony collapse disorder, this didn't really start in 2006. Actually, we started seeing problems in early 2004 and even back to 2003. I actually had friends of mine in Eastern Canada and New Brunswick that started telling me about issues and losing bees and mysteriously losing bees as far back as 2002. And now, as we go back and look at what was changing, was the fact was that we started changing our pesticide programs about that time, and these systemic pesticides, neonics, as Mary said to you tonight, those pesticides actually were started to use first in Europe in the early 1990s. And moved here to Eastern Canada to be used on potatoes somewhere around 1998, 2000. And at that point, we hadn't even seen those neonic pesticides used here in the United States. So beekeepers have always been of the fact that we are in control of what happens in the hive. If we had an issue with not feeding the bees when they were hungry and they starved, it was my fault. If we didn't move the bees to a new honey crop or something, it was my fault. If they had a disease problem and I didn't take care of the disease problem, it was my fault. But what happened here was, all of a sudden, we were faced with an issue that we had no control over, because something in the environment had changed. And the change in the environment was the fact that we changed our pesticide programs in this country to go to use a neonics. And to give you a little education about neonics, neonics are basically a pesticide that was designed to be translated through the plant, either be through ground being put on the seed and growing up through the seed into the plant, or being put on that plant as a foliar spray, and the plant uptakes it. Now, you're all aware of what nicotine does. You can chew tobacco, you can smoke cigarettes, you can rub it on your body, and that nicotine is going to go into your system. So what the manufacturers of these systemic pesticides, neonics, figured out was that if you take nicotine, and basically they're using an artificial nicotine, they're not using the same nicotine that we smoke in cigarettes, but it has the same effects, that if you put this in the plant and it grows up through the plant, you can basically control the insects, because of that plant, if that insect comes in contact with it, it's basically going to stop that insect from eating. with my farming background, and even though I left the farm, as I got older in life, I bought two farms. I don't farm. I have a friend of mine that I've grown up with. In fact, I live in the farmhouse that he grew up in and his family grew up in, but I own the farm. And my friend Bill and his son, we farms about 3,000 acres. And so I was well aware of what was going on in the farm community. I follow farming on a pretty real regular basis, of crop commodities and so on and so forth, because my passion has been farming all my life. And so when neonics came on the market in the early 2000s, it was sold to agriculturists as the answer to all our problems, because of the fact it was going to target that insect. It was going to take care of just that targeted insect. And it was going to take care of corn borer and aphids on corn and aphids on soybeans and so on and so forth. But what we learned later on was that it basically wasn't killing those bugs. It's basically breaking down their immune systems, causing them to quit eating. And so over the years, we started to look at honeybees and what was going on there, bees no longer are feeling well. They're sick. They don't eat. You don't eat. You don't feel well. And eventually you die. So that's basically how this whole thing works. So as bee numbers continue to dwindle across this country, I mean, back in the mid early 2000s, we probably had in the United States, we probably had somewhere in the neighborhood of 3.2 to 3.5 million commercially run beehives in the United States. That number, if you go look at statistics, that number dropped off drastically in them early, mid-2000 years. And today, we basically have somewhere between 2 and 2.5 million hives of commercial operated bees in the United States. Of course, as was said earlier, almonds has become one of the big factors and one of the big crops that has really grown in popularity, not only in this country, but around the world. And the only place that almonds is growing commercially and can be growing commercially is in California. You need three things to grow almonds. You need water, sunlight, and honeybees. And you need the right combination of the sun and the right combination of that water situation. So California, the San Joaquin Valley, is the only place really that, and so we've seen almond acreage grow there from somewhere in the 400,000 acres of almonds to over 1 million acres of almonds in the last number of years. It takes two hives of bees to pollinate an almond crop to put those almonds on the tree. And so with 1 million acres of almonds, and that's where we are now, roughly a million acres of almonds, it takes 2 million hives of bees in the dead of the winter. The almond tree is not very smart. It bloom in February when, that's winter time, but that's when the almonds bloom. So in the mid-90s, I did strike out and take some bees to California when pollination prices were at $50 a hive. And in those days, it was basically pay the truck drivers and said, yes, we did it. But today, the beekeepers are getting over $200 a hive to pollinate almonds in California. And the only problem is that most of us are having issues keeping these things alive, so it's harder and harder to get those numbers. And this past year, like the year before, barely came up with enough bees to cover the needs that was out there. You say, well, why doesn't somebody do something about this? There's been a lot of research, like Noah said, there's been a lot of research done. And most of the research is pointing to the fact that, yes, we have diseases, we have mites, we have pathogens, but we had all these things pre-systemic pesticides. We talk about they found some new types of new viruses and new diseases, but when you go back and start looking, these things were around even before that. They go back and dig up some of the old frozen bees that we have stored away from back in the 80s and the 70s, and they find, when they dissect these with new technology, they find some of these diseases, a lot of these diseases are already there. So there's only one thing that's changed, is the fact that we've changed our pesticide program, going to these systemic pesticides. And the fact is that it changed the environment of the honeybee. As in 2008, there's two national honeybee organizations, the American Beekeeping Federation and the American Honey Producers. those two organizations banded together and actually picked 8 individuals to basically deal with EPA and the chemical companies. We actually was invited by several chemical companies to sit down, and I guess they were going to try to educate us that they weren't the issue. But as the longer it went, it was fairly apparent that we knew as much as they, and probably more than they, because we were the ones that had our feet on the ground and knew what was going on. Unfortunately, you know, as citizens of the United States, we believe that most of us believe the government's here to help us. We think they're there to help us. I mean, we guess we know better than that. But EPA was created in the mid-70s to basically look after our environmental problems with chemicals, because at that time, chemicals were starting to get out of hand. And so they say, well, it's worse today than it was back then. And EPA should be taking a look at this and basically figuring it out. But unfortunately, EPA's hands are tied by the way the laws are written. And as Mary said when she introduced me, that we are basically suing EPA over some of these issues. And just to give you, we talk about pesticides, and pesticides covers not only insecticides, but fungicides and also herbicides. Covers all that, and rodenticides too, the things we use for rodents. All these products are supposed to be investigated before they're put on the market. Unfortunately, with a system that was developed and propagated by the chemical companies in the late 90s, now we have what is known as conditional registration. We put these products out there and basically let the environment tell us yes, no. Is it good for the environment, or isn't it good for the environment? Unfortunately, once these products are out, it's very hard to get them back off the market. Also, when systemic pesticides came on the market, the chemical companies and the seed companies realized that the easiest way to put this pesticide on seed was to basically coat it like a candy coating on corn, soybean, canola, and even some of our vegetable seeds. But the chemical companies were 4 years ahead. They're always 4 years ahead of everything that happens, and they were 4 years ahead of when systemic pesticide seed coating came on the market. 4 years before that, they went to EPA and Congress and created a clause in there that said that seed-coated articles will not come under these rules. So basically today, seed-coated articles are seed treatment on corn and canola and soybeans and some vegetables, as I said before. The largest use of pesticide in the United States, the largest use pesticide, the largest tonnage of pesticide used in this country is the seed treatment that goes on corn. If you go out and you go on the internet or anywhere and try to find how much tonnage of pesticide is being used on seed treatment of corn, it's impossible because of the fact there's no regulation. It's not a regulated article. So this lawsuit that was filed by myself, two other beekeepers, and several farmers, and also the Center for Food Safety, basically has taken EPA on the fact that this is basically an illegal action by EPA in the fact that we're the largest use pesticide that's out there is not even being There's no record of it. Interestingly enough, we filed this case in January. It's being heard in the 9th District Court in California. We have won, actually, the National Honeybee Advisory Board, which I'm co-chairman of, and the National Bee Organizations. We have taken on Dow and some other people out there in that same court over some other issues. One of them was the Foxiflora, and we won that case about a year ago. But this case is kind of different in the fact that we took on EPA, but the chemical companies, Crop Life America, has asked the court if they can defend the government. Now this is kind of interesting. You know, this is the chemical companies are actually asking the federal court if they can be a defense for the U.S. EPA. So that's all before us, and we don't know what will happen, but. We struggle and try to keep bees alive. We do a lot of things we never done before. We feed a lot of nutrition supplements to bees that Bees should be getting that food from nature, but because of the fact that the food has been contaminated, we basically try to supplement a lot of their feed by feeding them a lot of protein, high protein, and try to help them along. Some of it helps, and every year in this business is a different year. But as Noah said, you know, what you people can do is help the bees, help the native pollinators by getting out there and planting diverse forage. Like he said, you don't want to eat steak and potatoes all the time, and you sure don't want to eat vegetables all the time. So you plant a variety of flowers so that the bees have a variety of something to work on. Look forward to hearing some questions from you folks tonight, and take it from there. Thanks.
Thanks very much, David. So if you'd like to come up to the microphone, try and pinpoint your question so that all of the experts here can answer. And feel free to address any of the points that were raised, even if you disagree with them.
Great. Hi. Thank you so much for all the work that you're doing, both of you. I have a two-part question. One is, I thought that in Europe they ban the neonics now, and so I'm wondering if that's made an impact and the bees are starting to recover or not. And the other part is that I thought, I also heard that when I go to the garden store to try to buy flowers for my garden, those might have the neonics in them now and could be actually harming the native pollinators that I have in my yard. And is that true, or, you know, how can we...
Can you repeat your last question?
That some of the garden plants that you buy from a nursery also have these chemicals in them and could actually be doing more harm than good by buying flowers and trying to help bees in my yard. So
the answer to your first question is yes, Europe did put a ban on neonics, but what they really did was they made drawled lines, you know, from this area in France, from this area north, you can use neonics. From this area in south, you can't use neonics. Well, the interesting part is from that area south, or wherever they banned neonics or took neonics away, basically the bees are doing a lot better, I have a lot of friends in Europe. I have a lot of friends all over the world, Australia, and I mean everywhere. And so I talked to a lot of people, and yes, they are doing better. But as soon as you move into those areas, you got to understand that we do need chemicals. As a farmer, we need chemicals to farm, but we need to be responsible. There's a lot of new technology going, or a lot of new things going on in farming that farmers are doing themselves. We're going back to rotating crops. We're going back to planting a lot of heavy cover cropping, where we're planting in our operation. I said earlier, you know, my friend, we're farming 3,000 acres. Right now, we haven't even started to plant corn in Pennsylvania yet because we're waiting for the rye to get this high so we can roll that rye down, and that's going to be green manure, which basically gives us we're planting in a rainforest, and come summer when there's a drought, instead of having bare soil out there, we've got material that's holding the moisture. Your question about going to the store and buying plants. Yes, there is a lot of plants at the store that have been treated with systemic pesticides. The reason they did that was to keep that stuff alive so that, you know, the bulk stores, you know, where they're buying this stuff, you know, they buy those plants. Every one of them costs them money, so they want every one of them alive so they can sell it to you. Ortho, the chemical company Ortho, that basically deals with a lot of home plants, home things, about 2 weeks ago basically came out and said that we're taking all neonics products out of our product line. And some of the big stores, you know, the Home Depots, the Lowe's, and Walmarts have had a lot of discussion. There's a lot of discussion going on behind closed doors about the fact that, you know, they need to do something. And, I mean, there's some huge discussions. There's been huge meetings going on. I mean, there's a lot of things going on. There's a lot of people doing a lot of talking. But, you know, some days, you know, we need to move ahead. You know, the president came out with a declaration about we need to save the bees and all this. Unfortunately, you know, talk's cheap.
So is there a way to tell when I go to the store to buy my plants, whether they have these in them or not? No, like, can I?
You need to ask. And if they don't know the answer, they need to go find out the answer. They need to go back to the grower, the where they bought the plants, and was these plants treated with neonics, you know, and there's a whole large amount of different ones, but one of the things with neonics is the fact that yes, it's a pesticide, but yes, there's when you go pick up a pesticide on the shelf and you look at it, it's going to say there's 5% active ingredients. The problem is it may not be the active ingredient. It may be that other 90-some percent that's the inerts. They are putting all kinds of things in there. And one of the things that they're adding to these plants that you're buying to keep them plants green and healthy is they're putting others. And it may be even a pesticide. There may be another pesticide in there, but the chemical companies are covering it up as an inert ingredient.
In my moment of humor, I was at a anti-Monsanto demonstration at the State House a while back, and I yelled out the cry, if the bees are to be, then Monsanto is not to be.
As a farmer, we've seen the fact that Roundup, a lot of weeds started building resistance to Roundup a number of years ago. There's resistance to a lot of these chemicals. So at that point, there was chemicals coming in from abroad that were herbicides that were taken away from Monsanto's market. And all of a sudden, Monsanto came out with new and improved Roundup. And as a farmer, you know, we've seen that this new and improved Roundup actually did go back to working again. But in my travels to Washington, and I spend more time sometimes in Washington than I like to, and with EPA and other people, we found out that the reason that the Roundup's working is EPA left Monsanto basically double the amount of active ingredient in the Roundup. Now, that translates into another issue in the fact that we have a laboratory in Gastoria, North Carolina. The USDA has a laboratory in Gastoria, North Carolina that basically looks at food. They shop for food all over the United States. They got people out there on a regular basis shopping for food and testing this food to see what's in it. Right now, Food and Drug is, I guess the right word's worried because of the fact that the huge amount of Roundup that's showing up in our food supply. And behind scenes, there's, you know, Monsanto knows their days are numbered on the Roundup. But what happens is when this happens, the chemical company, whether it's Monsanto or whoever it is, when they find out that this product is probably going to be pulled off the market, their registration is going to be pulled, they start up and they crank the factories as hard as they can crank them, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, around the clock, producing product. Because when EPA basically pulls their registration or says, hey, you can't make any more of this, they have a clause in there that says, well, you can sell what you have sitting on your shelves. And so most of these chemicals that have been pulled off the market or their registrations have been removed, lots of them have been removed 10 years ago. You can still find those chemicals available because of the fact that, I mean, we're not just talking about Monsanto. We're talking about Crop Life America in general. This is how they operate, and so they basically crank up the, you know, and put this stuff away in storage, and so there's plenty of it out there to take them into another 10 years down the road.
Hi, thanks so much for being here and bringing some awareness about this. I've been trying to follow some of the policy in Massachusetts that's been floating around regarding colony collapse disorder in bees. I saw that the president of the MA Farm Bureau testified when there was a hearing about the new legislation that's out, and what he was saying was that if we ban neonics, the next pesticide that the farmers are going to be using is even more toxic and more dangerous. So I was wondering what you think about that. And along the same lines, I think the legislation said that only kind of citizens, like private citizens or whatever we are, would be banned from using it. You'd still be able to be certified as a commercial applier. So would that really have any effect on the bee health?
Think about all the things you asked. They're all good questions. They start from the back and work forward. Yes, in fact, about a week ago, the EPA took comments, or the comment period on making neonics a restricted use pesticide, only a restricted use pesticide. The comment period basically ended. Now they're going to look at the comments and so on. As I said, I'm co-chairman of the National Honeybee Advisory Board, and part of our job is commenting and getting the comments together, or our comments together, and we presented stacks of stuff, and we actually have a scientist that's a toxicologist, Dan Meyer, who's from the western part of the country, that put together this stack of stuff for us. And unfortunately, it's going to, basically what you said is, it'll become a restricted pesticide that only applicators and licensed applicators can use. What we don't realize is that when we look at these pesticide numbers, especially on neonics, taking out seed treatment, but other neonics, basically the ones that we do know, that we know what the usage are, residential use is 180 times what's being used in agriculture. Really? And maybe I'm probably talking to the choir here, but the homeowner goes into the store, picks up the container and looks at it, and this container says this is good for 1,000 square feet. Now we're talking about a little something. And it says this will treat 1,000 square feet. And a lot of them say we'll treat 1,000 square feet, or whatever it says. So the homeowner goes home and he's got a few roses, and he's got, a few roses or a couple more roses or something, and this container is good for 1,000 square feet. Well, I have these roses right here, and he takes this whole container and he sprays that whole container over that, 10 square feet, 100 square feet. And unfortunately, we have this mentality, little is good, more is better. Neonics are, when you start testing water, and nobody really wants to do this, but there's been some work done at University of Connecticut and some other places. When you start testing water, it don't much matter wherever it's been in the United States. The problem with neonics is the longevity of these products. When Bayer brought out cathioidin, which is poncho, which is the seed treatment on corn, and this is another problem because I told you about the conditional registration, they presented a booklet of stuff that's about that thick, 350 some pages. The first 15 pages was the conclusion, and that's basically all EPA looks at, was the conclusion. And then they give it conditional registration, and if something happens, it's us, the public's responsibility to prove to EPA that there's a problem. Well, that's never happened. But on page 12 of the conclusion, when Bayer brought out cathioidin, which is the most, like I said before, the most used neonic out there, it says this stuff has a short soil life, basically paraphrasing what it says. All you got to do is turn back to page 27 through 29 in the big book, and there they go on to describe the length of the soil life of cathioidin in the soil. The shortest life is almost 2 years in sandy soil. When it goes into heavy clays, it goes out to 7,000 and some days. 7,000 and some days is 19 years. So the problem is we keep putting this on, you know, the homeowner, the farmer, we keep putting this application on year after year, and we have extended this out, and it's become just a no-end situation. I think I missed your first question. About Massachusetts. Go ahead. You got the answer to that?
Yeah, sure. So in Massachusetts, it's actually a really exciting time for beekeeping legal issues. I know it sounds like a fascinating topic to everyone, right? But it should be, because this is really a listening time, or there have been an unprecedented amount of listening sessions at the government level going around all of Massachusetts for just that, listening. All the beekeepers are coming to the table, and the Farm Bureau, and everybody who has a say, pesticide applicators as well, which was your second question. And the good part is that it's creating dialogue. So New England Grows is a fantastic conference that happens now every December of the year, where pesticide applicators come together with beekeepers and landscape designers and nurseries, and everybody just at least has a dialogue. What's the update? What do you know? What should I know? What's changing? The down part is that there are a lot of stakeholders at the table, and that is confusing and slowing to politicians and government. It creates a bit of confusion at the government level, too, because when it's time for members of the House and the State Senate to pitch their pieces of legislation they want to get passed, it's for a really good cause, but beekeepers have specifically been saying that they don't feel that their voices are being heard loud enough, that they're not represented well enough. And so this has led to debate that has made its way to the Boston Globe and to news that sometimes show protests, because beekeepers really need to be heard. So do others. So that's really where it's at. It's really at a point of debate here in Massachusetts, but in other states, notably Maryland, banned neonicotinoids recently, and I think Minnesota might have been the other. Minnesota just did as well. And Marla Spivak is a wonderful researcher at the University of Minnesota. The pleasure of publishing one paper with her, a nice review about honeybee disease resistance, and I'm sure, Dave, you've worked with Marla as well. So she is a great voice for beekeeping. She's a MacArthur Foundation Fellow, one of these genius grants for her work with bee health, and they're building a brand new facility for research at the University of Minnesota under her direction. Right. So hopefully some more great things coming up, both from Maryland with Dennis Van Ingelsdorp, I think, who's over there too, and Minnesota with Marla, and Massachusetts with all of us here, and many more states hopefully to come.
Thank you both for your talk. I'm a little short for this. So I'm a honeybee researcher interested specifically in diet diversity. So I was wondering, Noah, if you have any data or speculation maybe about the diversity of honey and pollen that are found in these urban beehives versus these country beehives.
So great. So Rachel Benoen, everyone, who's a wonderful PhD student at Tufts looking at bee nutrition, and Rachel and I had the pleasure of doing a little study together at a strange indoor apiary as part of the MIT Media Lab project this winter. It was in a warehouse not far from here in Cambridge, where we had 8 beehives inside, and we were looking at a foraging study, right? And so that's something that you can follow up with Rachel on for results. I don't even know them. But in terms of what's out beyond are these artificial walls that we are in here, there's so much. And we started this great new project that we are working with everyday citizens and beekeepers on called Honey DNA. So it's a citizen scientist issue in a way, because we're sampling the pollen from any honey sample, and we basically sequence the genome of the honey. So you can taste the genome in a way. This helps us use molecular biology tools to know exactly what type of pollen and what type of nectar, therefore, is in the honey. It tells you what you're tasting. So our recent data, just from some pilot studies with Ann Madden and some other colleagues too, help us to determine exactly where bees are going. So we found in one sample here from Eastern Massachusetts, it was 18% dandelion, 16% clover, things that, okay, you might expect there too, but then in the lower percentages, we started seeing some really weird things. So we saw 6% oak, So that's really what's in bloom now, right? As I sneezed, I think, while you were giving your talk here, Dave, it's really, I have allergies. So that's what I might be allergic to and why some people find some solace and benefit from relief from allergies by eating local honey. It's a connection to that pollen, which is essentially an allergen. And so the more we continue our honey DNA studies, the more we're going to be able to learn exactly what flowers the honeybees are going to make their honey for every specific hyper-local region around the world. That not only helps our research, but also helps to inform citizens for what to plant or what to just let be, like these dandelions that are everywhere, right? And people think, ah, dandelion, spray it with a chemical, or not, right? Would it be so bad?
I also have one thought, too, that came to mind when you were talking about the height of the beehives in the urban areas. And I don't know how you would test this scientifically, but I'm wondering if maybe it's they're doing better there because it's more of that honeybee dream home, as Tom Seeley would talk about. Again, I don't know how you would test that, but maybe it's just going back to the bees' roots as far as they like to be up high versus in the ground.
That's right. Yeah, Tom Seeley is a great researcher at Cornell University, and he did this really interesting study looking at the natural habitat of bees by chopping down trees, as the story goes, in the woods around Ithaca. Measuring about 15 feet off the ground is where the average bee nest was in a tree. So that's the natural habitat, certainly not 50 feet plus, you know, skyscraper level. But as Rachel said, it really is the natural habitat, thinking bees as aerial creatures might be doing okay there.
Actually, I had a question myself, which wasn't really investigated. Much as I applaud the revival of the urban bee, and I think that's a lovely thing, it's kind of depressing to me that they've all left where they belong, which is the countryside and farmland. How much of this is due to monoculture caused by GM seeds, which discourages them foraging where they normally forage, in their natural habitat? So how much is GM seed responsible for the non-diversity and survival of bees? And in fact, we have someone here who has Jamaican hives, who I wanted to talk to mention about this, because she's already witnessed this because of GM seeds in Jamaica. So if you answer that, then if Ivy, you would address that.
We've gone to monoculture, which, I mean, we have acres and acres of corn, and we got acres and acres of soybeans, and we got acres and acres of wheat, and, you know, which part of the country you come from, or you got acres and acres of blueberries, or you got acres and acres of cranberries. And unfortunately, you know, that's not a good area for honeybees because of the fact that honeybees need a diverse diet, like Noah said, you know, and we. So the good news is there's a lot of farmers starting to plant what we call pollinator strips and so on and so forth to help that along. Even out, you know, he talked about what's going on in the city. Out in the country, you know, people are starting to keep bees. It's a thing to do. I mean, maybe not be a commercial beekeeper like myself, but most of them, you know, got a couple hives in their backyard, and they're trying to, you know, and it's an educational process, you know. This guy talks to his neighbor, and, you know, hey, this isn't good for my bees, and you know, it just, you know, it kind of mushrooms.
So I have another question, which is, I'm sort of shocked that home use of pesticides outweighs, or some of these pesticides anyway, outweighs what goes on in agriculture. So I'm wondering, is there an effort to bring these, you know, residential yard maintenance companies and educate them? Like, is there an organized, are those people becoming more educated, or are they just causing more and more problem?
Those people have been invited, the question you ask is, those people have been invited to lots of dialogue in, I sat on two committees at EPA, Pesticide Dialogue Committee, and I don't even know what the other one's called. and, you know, those folks, you know, whatever their title is, and they have a group, they have groups, they have a seat at the table, and they don't even show up. I mean, one of the things that you got to understand is when you start, unfortunately, when you sit down and you go visit the man with the green, the man's going by your community with a green truck, you know, spraying your neighbor's lawn, and you go out and have a talk with him, he'll be sure to tell you that, you know, this is my livelihood and this is what I do. Yes, he needs educated. I don't know how you educate him. I've had, my way of educating him is I stop when he gets all done and he puts some signs in your yard that says, do not walk your dog and cat for the next 24 hours. Well, if I can't walk my dog and cat, is this stuff really safe for me? Is this safe for you as an applicator putting this on? He's probably not going to answer you, but behind the scenes, there's a lot of people trying to educate these people. But at the other side of the coin is you have the pesticide companies that are pushing this stuff. It's a pyramid. I mean, you got Bayer, Syngenta, Dow, DuPont, you know, at the top, and it all the trickle-down effect. And down here at the bottom are these people that are, and you know, that are putting your lawn. And the more you benefit. I mean, as that applicator, the better deals he gets. And it just they've got a really good way of, I mean, the chemical industry has a very good way of, well, when you trickle over to the side, the farm side, you know, I've gone to a lot of pesticide and farm meetings. And one of the things that's changed here that has changed the whole picture of this chemical education thing is the fact that you go back into the 80s and the 90s, and the university systems, most of the university systems had extension people in each county. Long about the mid-90s, money started running thin, and one of the things that got cut early on was extension. And as people retired from extension, nobody filled that position. That created a big gap for education, and guess who stepped in to take care of the education? The chemical industry. I'll give you a little example. We pollinate blueberries. I've worked for Jasper Wyman and Sons, the largest American wild blueberry company. I worked for them. This will be my 45th year working for them pollinating blueberries. And we do a lot of research up there and try to, they're very positive and trying to how they, you know, they're spending a lot of money. They're spending millions of dollars a year to pollinate their blueberry crop with honeybees. So, you know, it's important to, you know, be nice to the bees. But one of the problems is fungicides. It takes fungicides to grow blueberries. You can't grow blueberries without having fungicides, or you'll have a mushy blueberry and nobody wants a mushy blueberry. But Dave Yarborough, who is the extension man at University of Maine, the blueberry extension fellow, a couple years ago told me, he said, David, he says, I'm going to have all my meetings this winter, I'm going to stress fungicide usage and cutting back amount of fungicides. Several days later, the Maine blueberry newsletter, whatever it's called, came out. I got my copy. I opened it up, big full-page ad, Syngenta, Helena Chemical Company and somebody else is having a meeting in Bangor. They're going to provide, at the Sheraton, they're going to provide breakfast, lunch, and evening snacks or something. And it's all free.
Yeah.
And when you look down at the program, they were going to talk about this new chemical they had, this new chemical they had, and this new chemical they had. Over here in a little block ad, there's a little ad that says Dave Yarborough on some Saturday at some elementary school is going to have a blueberry meeting. You know, you're invited. I called Dave on the phone. I said, what are we having for lunch? He said, we can't even afford to buy coffee. So you see where the growers, you know, you're giving them a free meal when they get their credits for, you know, as an applicator, you have to have, if you're a commercial applicator or you're a private applicator, you have to have credits to keep your license. So you go there and you get your credits. At the end of the day, what happens is they'll say, you know, we're going to have a special here on this product or that product. The first 20 people signing up, we're going to give you a coat and a hat, or we're going to give you a trip. You know, it's, I don't know how else to answer it.
I'll just add briefly, so I mentioned Marla Spivak a bit earlier, and she is at the University of Minnesota, and we were doing a joint interview for the TED Talks organization. Marla gave a great talk, and Dennis Van Engelsdorp was a third bee researcher involved in this, and they wanted us to interview one another, and she called me out. She said, Noah, you have to stop promoting this urban beekeeping thing. It is such a problem here. So she lives in St. Paul, and because pesticides are not regulated there, people don't know what they're doing and are spraying way more than they need to, and there are these massive kills that she will get called in for as the resident bee expert, and she doesn't have the time to deal with this stuff. So it's like the Wild West in cities these days, not just with the beekeeping, but with the pesticides too. So it is largely unregulated and something that we are only now beginning to talk about, and it's an important conversation to have.
Hi, thank you for providing those informations. I have a question about the card I got from the front desk called the Best Bees. So the delivery, installation, maintenance, and harvesting. I know Cambridge has 7 or 8 community gardens. I belong to one of the gardens on the Sacramento Street, which is a couple blocks from Harvard Law School, which has a concentrate of a lot of flowering plants. I'm wondering if there's a potential we can install a bee house there in the one of the community gardens. Is that going to boost the yield of the harvest, like we plant vegetables, tomatoes, and some berries, and we also have a byproduct of the honeys. Is any pro and cons about this idea? I have no idea about the bees. All I have is like I'm so scared to get stung.
Yeah.
And especially cross street is the Agassiz and Baldwin Street school. A lot of children sometimes visiting that community garden.
Yeah.
So I'm just asking if what is a good idea or bad idea.
Yeah, so bees are pollinators and they're great to have in a garden. It's something that is found around the world. So, you know, many people think if you plant a seed, then it grows to become a fruit. There's a little step that's missed, which is often the pollination part. And those are the bees. I mean, certainly there are other pollinators as well. There are about 200,000 different species of pollinators. But honeybees make great pollinators because they're generalists. They go to different flowers and different crops, and they kind of visit them all, saying hello throughout the day. But yes, it should have a good effect on the yield of the productivity of any garden, really. It also provides a wonderful opportunity for people to engage with sustainability because of the honey, as you said. So we work with many schools, from the Boston Public Schools down the street to Governor's Academy, which is a wonderful private school north of Massachusetts here, to not only be environmentally sustainable, but economically sustainable as well. So maybe you could sell the honey to raise funds for the garden. With this card here, it provides an opportunity for beekeepers to come assist. So maybe you wouldn't have to do the beekeeping now. It's kind of a new way to engage with the community. Bees can fly for miles, as Dave was saying, so the bees would not only pollinate your garden, but also bring more fruits and vegetables to Cambridge as well. So it can be a very good thing. And I'll just also add about a nonprofit based in Cambridge called Classroom Hives. Classroomhives.org is the website, and that is aimed at getting beehives in school classrooms behind glass, and the bees go in and out of a tube to the outside world, so no bees flying around where the kids are, but they put the books down and they look at mathematics in the beehive. Why is there a hexagon? What is that shape? Why not a square or a circle or a triangle? They understand communication through dancing, which was Nobel Prize winning research. So there's some great resources. It's a good thing, and I hope that your garden does get a beehive, and this card can probably help you out.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I just wanted to thank Noah Wilson-Rich and David Hackenberg for coming all the way from Pennsylvania for this very stimulating presentation. And thank you.
I'd like to start in a little bit of a different way tonight. And this is perhaps
already different because we're talking about insects. I mean, I'm not sure how many nights you really come to talks like this, but I'd like to start by thinking about how a bee sees the world. It's in a very different way from how we see the world, and it's kind of fun when I talk to school kids. I think about, let's look through the lens of the bee. Instead of all of these bright colors, bees see different colors. They see some things that we don't see, and we see things that they don't see. The world to humans is very hot, so we see reds. Bees do not see reds. We can see more yellow and orange and hot colors, and bees are more cool in what they see.